Hello, welcome to Sorely Wrestling Review. My name is Brian, but you can just call me Def. That was Elimination Chamber 2019. And holy shit, what a show. The finish in particular we'll get to it, but it was amazing. This is a fantastic show. Gonna give it a great show. You should fucking watch it. To run down the card, I believe there was only one match on the pre-show. I didn't catch most of it, but it looked like it was just the Cruiserweight Championship match, which was Akira Tozawa and Buddy Murphy. And the Cruiserweights always deliver with their 15 minutes of fame. I think this went about 15 minutes, and it was a stunning match. Akira Tozawa goes over the Murphy's Law, or Buddy Murphy goes over Akira Tozawa, hitting the Murphy's Law. Fantastic finish. And after the match, there was a segment with Mark Henry, of all people. Apparently, they've got a special coming out on him on the network that I didn't know about. So he came out there. He gave the Cruiserweights another round of applause, which it's well-deserved. This is a division that's severely underserved with how they're being positioned. And I don't know what you can do about it, being how they are just, trapped in their own world off to the network. But they had an amazing opener, pre-show sort of thing. But getting on to the main event, onto the main card, I seen some complaints before the show about the match order, because obviously there's two chamber matches for your titles on the line. So realistically, you want to bookend the show. You want to start with one and you want to end with one. Otherwise, there's, some awkwardness with the pacing. And I seen some people thinking, because of the historic nature of the tag titles, that should finish the show. But it was the first match on the card. I'm always of the philosophy, if your main title, if your top prize is on the line at any point at the show, it should finish the show. And I'm sorry, but the tag titles just aren't a top title. If you look at the teams involved in this match, you've got, Boston Hug Connection, Sasha Banks and Bayley. You've got Naomi and Carmella for some fucking reason. You've got the Riot Squad, you've got the Samoan SWAT team, Tamina and Nia Jax, and you've got Sonya Deville and Mandy Rose. Apparently they're called Fire and Desire now. That sounds like a fucking poor name, to be honest with you. But apparently that is what they're going as. So, if you look at these teams here, there's not, outside of Sasha Banks and Bayley, and Nia Jax in the eyes of WWE. So of the nine, I can't do math. Of the 12 women in it, maybe three of them are top talent. And even still, you're really only looking at one or two of them that could properly hang at the top level. It just doesn't make any sense to put this on last. I mean, they had an amazing match. The women did an impeccable job as far as tag chambers go. There's only been two or three of them to really compare it to. But this wasn't the worst one I've seen, for what it's worth. There was a couple of spots. The first elimination goes to the fucking Iconics. I am in love with Peyton Royce. She's one of the... Her and Billie Kay are one of the best things on SmackDown. So just to see them get a moment, even if it's just a little moment, makes me so happy. Billie Kay gets a sunset flip roll-up pin. And then Peyton Royce on top of it does the jump over bridge pin as well. I forget the name of it, but it looks beautiful, and they get the first elimination. It just makes me happy. As far as the rest of the match goes, there's a lot of fundamental tag team wrestling. There's a lot of tag team moves, a lot of isolating one person versus the other. It's not something I was really expecting going into these chamber matches. It generally means to be one-on-one encounters where everyone's just knocking their specials and their finishers and their signature moves. Everyone's getting their moment. Everyone's having a chance to shine. But what I enjoyed about this one is you saw a lot of the tag team stuff, even from teams that don't traditionally have a full tag team repertoire, like the Riot Squad. They've been together forever, but you don't see them winning a whole lot, and you don't see them in the actual tag matches a whole lot to where they can properly utilize combination moves and finishers that aren't just the generic, heel, stop, stomp a guy in the corner, whatever the case is. But you got to see some of that. You got to see some of the shine that they have as units and not just as singles competitors. Even Sasha Banks and Bayley, which are the definition of two singles guys that just have been lumped together by circumstance for the last few months, almost a year now. However long this fucking thing has been going on. But they even had a couple of circumstances going for them as well. There was a spot where Banks hits the bank statement and immediately comes into the Bayley to Bayley suplex. The one interesting elimination was when Nia Jax tried to do the bulldoze thing on the outside where she's like shoving people into the pods, into the sides of the chambers. She missed her target. I believe she was trying to like plow through Bayley. She missed her target, runs into the chamber wall and just gets knocked unconscious. And then you flash the ring reaction and Tamina is terrified. It's like, what the fuck just happened? And she starts to realize she is surrounded by everybody in the match. She eats like four finishers in a row and they pin Tamina to get the team out of there. I just think that was a very interesting way to protect Nia Jax, who they clearly have better plans for some fucking reason. The finish of the match, the final two teams, it's the same four, I believe, from the last Women's Elimination Chamber last year. Sasha Banks, Bayley, Sonya Deville, and Mandy Rose. Fire and Desire and the Boston Hug Connection. So, for what that's worth, those are your final two teams. And there's a very interesting sort of chasing around the outside of the chamber, and then they had a callback to last year's spot where everyone had climbed on top of one of the pods and it looked like potentially they were going to have another betrayal segment, but it didn't come that way. What actually happened is as they fought back off of the pod, Bayley gets laid out this time compared to the previous couple of weeks where Sasha Banks is the one that's been taking the powder and it's been on Bayley to try and save the day. In this case, the roles are reversed. Bayley gets taken out and Sasha Banks is the one who has to fight off the competition. And at the end of it, she does. She takes care of Mandy Rose, which isn't particularly hard to do. She's probably like the weakest competitor in here outside of the Iconics. And as far as Sonya Deville goes, she gets a modified bank statement. She can't, her arm is taped up, so she can't, in kayfabe, reach around to fully lock in her hold. So what she does is she hooks her leg across the neck instead, just apply the pressure, and that's all it takes. They get Sasha Banks and Bayley finally have some payoff to the rut that they've been in for the last year or two, so it seems, after I want to say like half an hour. It was a fairly decently length chamber match, but it was really good. Like, it doesn't, chambers are hard to describe blow by blow because there's a lot of stuff happening. There's a lot of competitors involved. It's the same issue with the Royal Rumble from the last movie pay-per-view. I can't go into detail with every single spot, otherwise this video will be an hour long. But it was a good tag chamber match. It wasn't the best match on the show, in my opinion, but that's not to say that this was a bad match. It's just there was a lot of good matches on the show. And speaking of good matches, from the Women's Tag Team Championships, we move on to the SmackDown Men's Tag Team Championships, which is Miz and Shane McMahon versus the Usos. And this was the culmination of the world's greatest tag team as they're on top of the mountain, and now it's a question if they can stay on top of the mountain. And as it turns out, they can't. The Usos are OP in kayfabe, and just what can you do about them? And the match played out very interestingly because it saw a lot of tag team maneuvers, which is weird for tag teams. But Miz and Shane, up till previously, are, again, just like two single guys that kind of got lumped together, and they showed like proper tag team prowess. There's a lot of trading, lots of back and forth between the two of them splitting the load. They did the callbacks to the traditional Shane McMahon spots. He hit the coast to coast. He got derailed on the second attempt, and then that's beside the point. And then for the other big spot is the table elbow to the outside. How that man is still doing that thing. From the top of the turnpost to the outside table, every almost every week, every month it seems he pulls out the spot. How are you still alive at 50 making that jump? It hurts me just looking at it. It really does. It's a very amazing spot. It's one of those, no matter how many times you see it, like, dear God, please quit it. You're going to kill yourself. The tag titles don't mean that much, I'm telling you, man. And after the dive to the outside, Miz is on his own, essentially. Shane McMahon doesn't really make much of an appearance. And the numbers are overwhelming. The Usos are proving why they're one of, if not the best tag team in the industry, in WWE at the very least. They put on a clinic on the Miz, and it's just, it's too much. And this leads to Miz freaking out after the end of the match, because this was his dream. His papa was proud of him, and it doesn't go so well. There wasn't a physical confrontation, but you get the sense that kind of SmackDown, something's going to explode, because this did not go the way that they wanted it to. And I'm thinking you could see a Miz versus Shane McMahon thing at WrestleMania, which I would be fine with. So we'll find out. After that is Bobby Lashley and Lio Rush in a handicap match versus Finn Balor. The title is on the line here in the handicap match, and I fucking hate this stipulation, because whenever there is a title defense in a handicap match, it is only ever done with one outcome. The weaker of the handicaps gets pinned. It is a stupid thing to protect your champion so he can lose the title without appearing like he got beat. And the match was good. You know, Bobby Lashley is fantastic. Lio Rush is really good. Finn Balor is obviously amazing. Like, they had a good match. I just fucking hate the stipulation because it's predictable. You knew the second they started it, leading into the last couple of Raws where Finn Balor had already beaten Lio Rush. You knew this was going to end one way. A fucking coup de grace from Finn Balor to Lio Rush while Bobby Lashley had been isolated and taken care of. And that's exactly what fucking happened. Finn Balor is the Intercontinental Champion, which is a good thing. I love Finn Balor, and he needs something to stay relevant at the moment, because there's a time coming, I hope relatively soon, where he is your champion, or at the very least, he is in line to be your champion. In order to do that, he needs to stay up at that level. I just hate the stipulation going into this, because it's fucking predictable. Probably this clears Bobby Lashley to be Seth Rollins' first feud once he takes the title at Mania, if he takes the title at Mania. But we'll see. So that was that. That was probably like, that was the second low point of the night. That was the second lowest. And even still, it's only because the stipulation was predictable. They had a good match. It was a good 10 minutes of what you can expect from, you know, the Speed versus Braun matchup of a fucking monster MMA fighter, Bobby Lashley, and the Speed teaming that is Finn Balor. Going on from that one was the Raw Women's Championship match, and this was Ruby Riott getting destroyed by Ronda Rousey. I'm not even going to fucking sugarcoat. This match was the literal definition of an afterthought. It literally got added to the card between shows, between Monday and Tuesday. There was no announcement of the show. It was just, there is now a title defense on this night. There was no promo. Ruby Riott never got to say her shtick on television. All she got was a Twitter promo. It was an amazing Twitter promo. Ruby Riott deserves better than this. And she just, I don't expect her to win, obviously, because she's not at that level yet. But you need to start building people up. And this was a squash match. This was centered around the fact that Charlotte Flair was at ringside scouting her competition. So Ronda Rousey just glares at Charlotte the entire time and still manages to destroy Ruby Riott in like 2 minutes. This match was the low point for me, because Ruby deserves better. Again, I don't expect her to win, but at least give her like 5 minutes. Let her do something and pretend at least for once that she has a hint of a chance, or at the very least play up the thought that Charlotte could get interference a bit more into it, like have her stand up on the apron or just something. It was just stupid. The interesting point to this segment is immediately after the match, Becky Lynch comes in through the crowd on crutches because there was a story, again, breaking on Twitter and YouTube, but not on the main show because, you know, fuck continuity or, you know, where your main audience actually watches your shit. But there was an incident at a house show from a couple days ago where Becky Lynch had tried to rain on the parade, basically, of Charlotte at a SmackDown house show, and she got beat and re-injured her knee was the storyline after being cleared on Monday. So for this show, when she is coming through the crowd, she's walking in there on crutches. No one stops her. There's no security. The open area around the barricade through the timekeeper's area was available to her. She just limps up just slowly through past all the fucking guards and the railing. Again, in kayfabe, she's not supposed to be here. She's suspended, and if she has a ticket, she's a fan, so she's not supposed to get this close anyways. But again, no one fucking stops her. So she just crutches her way into there, gets into ringside, starts the stare down, and starts the trash talk with Charlotte and with Ronda Rousey. And then she drops a crutch and just starts beating the shit out of Charlotte with it. It was fantastic. I lost my goddamn shit. The audience lost their goddamn shit. Michael Cole lost his goddamn shit, and fuck Michael Cole, okay? Fuck you. That's all I'm going to say. And fuck WWE for trying to push this idea that Becky is a heel or she's doing something that isn't deserved. She had her opportunity stolen from her and keeps fighting to get it back. So fuck you if you think that's a bad storyline. She's acting out of character. This has been her character for the last fucking year, is fighting for what she feels is hers. Anyways, the commentary for this really, really bothered me because Michael Cole was just going all in. It felt like they were trying to do another fucking heel turn for Becky Lynch. Listen to your crowd here. It's not going to happen. It doesn't matter if she's suspended or if this is the wrong approach to take. Charlotte injured her again is the storyline. Why would she not take the chance to make it even? You would expect the exact same behavior from literally everybody else on roster. After Charlotte is beaten the shit out of, she rolls to the outside, or she rolls to the corner to sort of recover. Ronda and Becky have a bit of a stare down. And then Becky takes a crutch and beats the shit out of fucking Ronda Rousey with it. I mean, it's fucking great. It's one of those you didn't expect. Because you just expected, you know, we have a stare down. It's like, we understand each other. Nope, she just fucking wails the goddamn thing across her back. It's amazing. The crowd loses their shit. I lost my goddamn shit. Michael Cole gets pissed off because fuck him again. It's just an amazing segment. It really was. And it sold the fact that this is your most over talent, despite the fact that she's there against the rules of the authority or whatever. The crowd has lost its goddamn shit. They fucking love Becky Lynch, and for good goddamn reason. She's an amazing character, and she has this fire and this passion that you don't see on their broadcasts. You don't see this in the content that WWE produces recently. That's why the fans are gravitating towards her so much, because she has it. She has that thing, that charisma, that it factor. And the people just gravitate towards it. Going on from that hot segment of Michael Cole making me want to shiv myself, there is Baron Corbin versus Braun Strowman in a no disqualification match. I don't really get why Baron Corbin is still at the level he is. Like, I get he's tall. I get that he's an okay promo. But that's really it. He's an okay promo, and he's at best an okay wrestler. Like, he's not the complete package. He just doesn't have near as much charisma, or he's not nearly as over as I think his spot in the card is demanding of him. So I don't really get it. As far as this match goes, it was your very typical fucking big guy heel versus monster babyface. They just chased each other around and beat the shit out of each other for a little while. And then Baron Corbin, when he is down and out, when he's on the ropes, Cue the music for the Scottish psychopath. We're not done yet. Once, as he gets down in there, as he starts to interfere, Drew McIntyre levels the playing field a bit. In comes fucking Bobby Lashley as well. And then, clearly, none of these guys are having a fantastic night, so the three of them just essentially murder Braun Strowman for the next, like, 5 minutes. And then eventually the finish is this really fucking cool slam through two tables, and just Braun Strowman gets laid the fuck out. And clearly this is going to set up something at WrestleMania. I would hate to see, like, a 3-versus-1 scenario at Mania, because this... I mean, fuck all with Baron Corbin. I don't give a shit what the hell they do with him. But Drew McIntyre and Bobby Lashley deserve better than to be outweighed against Braun Strowman. They deserve better than being fed to that man in such a poorly done scenario. If this is like a one-on-one scenario with either one of these guys, I would be fine with. But it looks like they might be leaning towards handicapped, and as a way to get Braun Strowman over, is to keep him over for some reason. They have to keep topping the last thing. And at certain point, you're reaching a breaking point. You're doing much more harm than good to the rest of the roster at the point of trying to keep him up there. It was an interesting finish, and I am very, very curious to see what they do going forward. Because like I said, you've got amazing talent here. You've got Drew McIntyre. You've got Bobby Lashley. You've got Braun Strowman. So there's a lot of elements involved, and I'm interested to see what they do with them. I'm concerned about what seems like the obvious outcome just from the face of it, and I'm hoping that there's a different plan, you know? After that, it goes to the main event. This is the Elimination Chamber match for the SmackDown Championship. Daniel Bryan, AJ Styles, Jeff Hardy, Randy Orton, Samoa Joe, and Kofi Kingston. This match was amazing. Like, legitimately, and it almost got me. The ending almost got me. You had... It was just fantastic. It delivered is all I can really say for it. And there was some amazing spots. All the guys involved in it were fantastic. Again, this is another one of those where I feel like I'm spoiling it for you if I go into too much detail. Watch the goddamn match. If you like WWE, if you're reading a fucking random idiot on YouTube doing a review for it, then you should be invested in this project. You need to watch this match because it was really fucking good. Daniel Bryan enters first, and then there's AJ Styles. I forget the order of entries. It was Bryan, Styles, Joe, Kofi, Hardy, and then Orton was obviously the last guy. I forget the exact order of entries and eliminations, but that is the gist of it. And Jeff Hardy gets this really cool... There's a couple of spots I'll touch on, but the first one is a Jeff Hardy spot where he lays AJ Styles out on the ring post, where he's laying face down on the ring post, and he hits a swanton off the top of an elimination pod to the back of AJ Styles as he's laying on the ring post. And as he is trying to get up from hitting that amazing fucking move, he gets blasted in the face by Daniel Bryan's knee, and Bryan gets an elimination off of that. There's an elimination with Orton to where AJ Styles jumps up to hit the phenomenal forearm, and Orton, while AJ is still standing on the rope, grabs him and then plops him for the RKO. That looked fantastic. The interesting part is the finish, because the final two, it comes down to Daniel Bryan entering first against Kofi Kingston. And this is where it essentially kicks into another gear. And this is the best part of the night, is this final segment where it's just the two of them inside this steel monstrosity, and they beat the shit out of each other. They just absolutely go hard, hitting all their moves, all their finishers. So many false finishes to this match. Kofi hits the SOS. He hits the fucking Trouble in Paradise. Brian hits the knee. He hits the stomp thing. I don't know if they have a name for it, where it's where he just holds the arms of the bad guy and just starts kicking them in the face repeatedly. He gets the lapel lock even. There's a spot. Or the finish of the match revolves... Again, I feel like I'm spoiling it because it's such an amazing... It's an amazing finish. But the ending to the match, the two of them work their way up to the outside onto the top of one of the pods. It's happened a lot, actually, during the course of these matches tonight. And I hope for the next match to do it a bit less. But I digress. But as they get on top of the pod, there's debates on to if they're hitting... trying to hit a suplex. And then there is a spot where Kofi's ramming the head of Daniel Bryan into the cage wall behind him. And Bryan, from this onslaught, starts to back down, tries to climb off onto the top of the ring post and back into the ring. And halfway there, Kofi Kingston just starts blasting him with like the stiffest fucking kicks to the face and knocks Daniel Bryan down into the center of the ring. And you've got this scenario where there's a guy laying in the middle of the ring and there's another guy on top of a pod 15 feet in the air. You know where the fuck this is going, right? And so Kofi Kingston eyes him up, goes to the fucking frog splash and misses. You could feel the energy in this room deflate after that. Bryan hits him with the second knee of the night, maybe the third knee, I forget. But either way, it's the second finisher in a short order, gets the pin. Daniel Bryan retains. So defeated. They almost had me. There was times, there was more than one time even when you thought Kofi could fucking do this. They have precedent for doing this where, like, there's a hot change right before WrestleMania. You change it at a chamber and you change it back at Fastlane. Like, they've done this before, so I was hoping, against hope, that you could see a title change. Kofi could get his moment. It wasn't meant to be, at least not tonight. And this makes, I believe... they've had 16 chambers, elimination chamber matches now, and I believe half of them now, the champion is retained in one form or the other. If that should tell you something, there might actually be a champion's advantage to this fucking match, as weird as it sounds. But Daniel Bryan retains in spectacular fashion. It is an amazing match. Again, you should watch it. Me describing a couple of spots here doesn't do it justice. To end off the show, as Bryan gets carried off to the outside by Rowan, by his intellectual equal, that's the New Day come down and they lift Kofi up as he is obviously in the gutters, so to speak. He was this fucking close, this close. And the show ends with him trying to hold his head up high because he delivered. The performance of the night goes to Kofi Kingston for his emotional roller coaster of a segment there. I'm hoping that this isn't the end for Kofi Kingston. I'm hoping at WrestleMania, that's your opponent. They've had a question of who do you slot in to face Daniel Bryan. Because at the moment, as a heel champion, there's not a lot of strong faces on the opposite side of things. So you could do a situation where it's like a heel versus heel, and, you know, he'll fight like a Randy Orton or a Samoa Joe, but that's not a good dynamic to book around because the fans are just going to fucking shit on the match, basically. So the ideal scenario is you want a strong babyface against your heel champion. And there's questions, you know, could Mustafa Ali work? But, I mean, he just debuted and now he's injured, so that's probably not going to happen. They would need to do a lot of work to get him to that level. Could Rey Mysterio is still around? He's still in the mix. Though, again, he's lost the last couple weeks, so that's going to require a lot of work to rebuild him. I know the Kofi thing wasn't the plan going into this match, but I think you have found someone the fans can get behind. Fucking go full in on it. The New Day, in my opinion, as a tag unit, has ran its course. I mean, they've been together for like 4 years now, like five or six time tag team champion, longest reigning Raw tag team champions of all time. So I think it's time. And I don't want to see them like turn on each other and like the proper WWE explosion that seems to happen where they all fucking feud together. But lift one of them up to the main event. And I think Kofi, at least in the immediate future, could be that guy. So I don't know. We'll see how it plays out. Because there is one thing left. There's Roadblock, Fastlane, whatever the fuck they want to call it. There's one little special left between them and WrestleMania. So the entire build from here on out is the driving force to see where they go. We'll see what happens if Becky and Ronda become a one-on-one again, or if Charlotte gets added as a triple threat. We'll see how Seth and Brock Lesnar can fucking stay interesting for 6 more weeks. I really don't know. Because, I mean, they've really hit a ground with that. What the fuck is happening with Asuka as the SmackDown champion? She literally hasn't been on television since the Royal Rumble. There's that still hanging out there. Obviously, there's new tag champions that they'll need to fucking fit in there somewhere. So there is a lot of questions left to find out what the end goal is, what their plan is. And I'm interested and I'm excited after a good show like this. I'm excited to see what they do next. But anyways, that'll be it for me. We'll see you next time.